Ces t-shirts un peu à la Tyson, elle est sur tout court. Et quand je dis, vous devez tomber. Good luck to both of you, gentlemen.
Start with this. Well, the WBO 126-pound champion, Amanda Serrano, is going to be locking horns with her old nemesis, Diana Santana, in what is a rematch that's going down, not in the squared circle, but in the cage. Oh. On January 25th, early next year, they're going to be part of a promotion for Combate America, set to be going down in Puerto Rico. And my thoughts on Amanda Serrano's participation in this promotion, given what else is going on, it further denotes, it further accents what I've been saying all along, that this girl has a wavering commitment to the sport of boxing and a wavering commitment to what is the Katie Taylor fight. I mean, we're just now receiving news that Delphine Persoon is out of the running for the Katie Taylor rematch, that, you know, she's not going to be around for that fight to happen. She's decided to go the Olympic route and try to win, you know, Olympic gold. You know, make of that what you will. There is a conflict of interest there for some, you know, that a fighter with as much professional experience as what Delphine's got, it's kind of tactless, it's kind of tacky for her to be pursuing Olympic gold against less experienced fighters than herself. There's that conversation, and that conversation is more suited for another day. Because here today, the relevance of Delphine is that, okay, she's out of the running as what could be Katie Taylor's next opponent. So the natural assumption would be that now is the ideal time for the Amanda Serrano fight. Yet here we see that she's all booked up, at least for January. But Amanda Serrano has once again found something else to do, whether it's pursuing titles in different weight classes or looking to unify them or participating in promotions in sports that are of different disciplines. Amanda Serrano always seems to have something to do.
Something else.
An argument can be made that perhaps Amanda Serrano had no knowledge of Delphine retiring, that she didn't see that coming, she didn't know that was going to happen, so how's that her fault? Well, I'll tell you. When you want something, you tend to prioritize it. And the fact of the matter is, there is a question as to whether or not Amanda Serrano really wants that Katie Taylor fight, when, if that's something you're after, if that's something you want, if you want to be the next girl that she fights, you keep your dance card open, regardless of what's going on with someone else. If you're actively pursuing that fight, the logical assumption is that you would keep your dance card open so that you could have it. But time and time again, Amanda Serrano proves that she's always got something else to do. And this Combate Americas card reads as more of a novelty attraction than an actual attempt to cross over, because Diana Santana has no experience in the octagon or the cage or whatever you want to call it. This would be her debut, and comparatively, this is in no way, shape, or form the same size, the same scale, the same magnitude of an event that the Katie Taylor fight would be. You're willingly participating in smaller situations than what the Katie Taylor fight would be.
Why is that?
I have no other way to interpret that other than, you know, Amanda's just not crazy about that fight because she always seems to find something else to do. Diana Santana is no more a mixed martial artist than Amanda is, you know? And the fact that Amanda's fighting someone in the cage that she beat already in the squared circle, that really does read like more of a novelty act than an actual attempt to cross over. That's the most I can make out of this card. That's the most I can make out of this situation, that this event isn't so much as a blip in the world of mixed martial arts, yet for some reason Amanda Serrano is prioritizing this as opposed to the mega matchup against Katie Taylor and keeping herself primed, keeping herself ready for that. She places no importance on that. And this is what the talk has been, that she's quote-unquote not waiting for Katie Taylor.
We can see that.
In reality, Katie isn't keeping you waiting. You're more or less keeping them waiting, you know? But it is what it is. Like I said, this further accents what I've been saying all along, that Amanda Serrano, time and time again, exhibits not only a wavering commitment to the Katie Taylor fight, but to the sport of boxing. And if by some chance that fight doesn't come off, we will have that wavering commitment to attribute to it. In other news, former unified champion Andy Ruiz had this to say. He says, "I'll be back stronger. I will be a champion once again. I appreciate all the love and support from my true fans. I appreciate the haters as well, and can't wait to prove the haters wrong once again. Back to the gym. Let's start this journey to the belt." And, you know, in one of my previous videos, I talked about, you know, a potential Andy Ruiz versus Adam Kownacki fight, how that would be a good
matchup and a good name to
bounce back with, and that a fight like that would have a very crowd-pleasing aesthetic, the kind of aesthetic that could get Andy Ruiz back in the mix of everything, because in Adam Kownacki, you've got a volume guy, and in Andy Ruiz, you have a skilled counterpuncher. A fight between the two would be fantastic. But Adam Kownacki is not the only name that Andy Ruiz could bounce back with. There is also the name of Luis Ortiz. That's right. Both of these guys, they're on the same side of the street, and Luis Ortiz, the name of Luis Ortiz, is often used as, I don't know, some kind of a litmus test or a gatekeeper for guys that are actually more proven than Luis Ortiz. You're always hearing about how Anthony Joshua has got to fight Luis Ortiz, or Dillian White has got to fight Luis Ortiz, when those two guys have actually proven more than Luis Ortiz has.
Yeah.
I mean, all things considered. Look at their resumes. Look at the number of top 10 fighters and champions or former champions that both those guys have defeated. All things considered, I wouldn't be against seeing either Anthony Joshua or Dillian White fight Luis Ortiz. I am just against this notion that they have something to prove to him, when in all actuality, it's Luis Ortiz who's got a lot to prove. Because outside of losing to Deontay Wilder two times, he really hasn't done much.
Now that both Andy Ruiz and Luis Ortiz are on the rebound, they're both coming off losses, they're both guys that are on the same side of the street, I think an Andy Ruiz versus Luis Ortiz fight makes a lot of sense. And if a fight like that were to be staged on Fox, you know, as opposed to Showtime, if the PBC were to stage a fight like that on Fox in what is the foreseeable future, well, I think they could actually do really good viewership with a fight like that.
Yeah, they could.
In terms of the PBC's heavyweight roster, you gotta realize that they don't have all that much to go around. You know, there's no intrigue in a you know, Andy Ruiz versus Efe Ajagba, or an Andy Ruiz versus Charles Martin. You know, you're just not gonna get much of a reaction for those kinds of fights. But if you pit these two top 10 fighters, if you pit Andy Ruiz in there with Luis Ortiz, yeah, I think you could do really good viewership for a fight like that. And it's the ideal situation for both guys, given the risks involved. That would be the stepping stone for them to re-enter the conversation and get back into the mix of everything. Get back into the mix of world title contention. You know, you did what you had to do with Anthony Joshua. You've had two fights with that guy. But if you're going to go on another title run, it's conceivable that you're going to have to get Deontay Wilder in your crosshairs. Because now that you're back on the PBC side of things, that's the closest world title to you. I'm sure that you guys have seen some of Deontay Wilder's recent comments in regards to, you know, the unification match with Anthony Joshua, that he doesn't want the fans to get their hopes up because that is a fight that will never happen. That's according to him, okay? That's not coming from me. That's coming from your boy Wilder. That fight will never happen. And, you know, if this is the demeanor that Deontay Wilder has towards that fight, okay, well, you're talking about potentially trying to break Rocky Marciano's record. You're a couple of fights away from doing that. You know, you're going to have to have a couple of fights before you get to that point. So who are you going to get to that point with? You know, one of the guys that Wilder could end up locking horns with is the former unified champion, Andy Ruiz. I think that should be the first order of business for Andy Ruiz. Get that guy in your crosshairs and work your way towards him. One way to really, you know, put a stamp on things and make a statement that you're back, you're all the way back, is to have a fight with Luis Ortiz, you know? See how you look against that guy, and see if that don't get you a title shot at Deontay Wilder.
Andy Ruiz's success, you know, now that he's on the rebound, really hinges on the earnestness of his efforts and his discipline, which, you know, is rumored to have been a problem. You know, that this is a guy who wasn't living right, wasn't training right when he was with Top Rank, and that's why they allowed him to buy himself out of his contract. That's why they let him go. And we see here, you know, in what was supposed to be the preparation for the Anthony Joshua rematch, that those disciplinary issues, they have resurfaced. That this guy, you know, he was treating the situation kind of just, you know, cavalier and blasé. You're not taking this seriously, at least according to Andy. So that denotes a constant, that Andy Ruiz is a guy who's got motivational issues, discipline issues, and if he's going to have a successful comeback now that he's on the rebound, he's going to have to nip that in the bud. Who knows if he can? But I'll say that, yeah, you know, one way he can go about it, you know, at least one other way he can go about it is, you know, he could fight Kaunaki or he could fight Luis Ortiz. They're on the same side of the street as him, so I don't see why there should be any problems making those fights.
And finally, I'm sure you guys have heard already that both Tevin Farmer and Jojo Diaz have agreed to terms. They are going to be locking horns on January 30th on the undercard for what is Demetrius Andrade's title defense against Luke Keeler, a fight we have discussed on this channel in a previous video. I'd have to say that, things considered, this is the most interesting fight the 130-pound division has seen in a little while, you know?
Yeah.
Because this is a fight that in some ways is a grudge match. This is a fight that does have some backstory. We have been waiting for this particular matchup between Tevin Farmer and Jojo Diaz, two guys that really don't like each other. And given the styles of both of the fighters, it makes for fireworks. You know, Tevin Farmer is known for his defensive prowess, how he is a very defensively responsible boxer. But the beauty of Tevin Farmer is he's not a stick-and-move outside kind of guy, you know? He's not a limited output mobility guy. His defensive prowess is inside of the pocket, in the line of fire. Within the line of fire, that leaves him in a prime position to get off those counter shots, those counter hooks, those counter uppercuts. In that way, he's definitely a defensively responsible fighter, but he still makes for action-packed fights, similar to what we saw when he squared off against John O'Carroll. And in Jojo Diaz, what he's going to be facing is one of the top 10 fighters at the weight. A guy who sports a knockout victory over the likes of Andrew Cancio, former champion Victor Terrazas. Understand that Jojo Diaz has only ever lost one fight.
That's it.
One fight over a year ago against Gary Russell. And since that fight, he's racked up four.
Count them.
Four consecutive victories. So this is a guy that, all things considered, has been keeping busy. Since May of 2018, this guy's fought four times, won four times. And in terms of activity, the same can be said of Tevin Farmer. Since traveling to the land down under for what was then the vacant IBF title against Billy Deb, Tevin Farmer has racked up five, count them, five consecutive victories. This is a guy that's been staying sharp, staying busy, and staying receptive to whatever fights he can have. So in Farmer versus Diaz, essentially you have two guys that have been staying busy and staying sharp. Thus, there are no excuses to be made here. These are both two guys that are on their P's and Q's. And in this situation, either man is going to be the stiffest test that the other has faced in recent memory. For Tevin Farmer, it's a chance for him to make some waves in the 130-pound division with an opponent that's a step up from the guys that he's been fighting. And for Jojo Diaz, it's a chance for him to become a bona fide, full-fledged world champion. I'd say that if Tevin Farmer, hypothetically speaking, by some chance emerges the victor, the next course of action really should be getting the people at Top Rank on the phone and setting up a unification match, unification matches. Because this is a division where the world titles really are split four ways. You've got Leo Santa Cruz holding the WBA and holding it hostage. You've got Jamel Herring holding the WBO. You've got Miguel Burchelt holding the WBC. And if Tevin Farmer is successful, he will be holding on to the IBF. If he can make his way past Jojo Diaz, there are no other fights that make sense for him other than unification matches. And it's going to become time for Top Rank to once again work with Matchroom and make a big fight happen, make something happen that will get attention for the division in all the ways that the Hooker versus Ramirez fight got attention. You know, you've got to establish an authority at these weights. Champions operating independently of other champions doesn't help anybody. It doesn't help the fighters, it doesn't help the division, and it certainly doesn't satisfy what the fans want to see. The fans want to see these world titles consolidated as much as possible. So if Tevin makes his way past JoJo, that really should be the course of action, because other than that, you know, I just don't know what else there is left for him to do.
You know, the way they've got this thing built, it's kind of curious, because I'd say that Farmer versus Diaz, all things considered, is more worthy of being the main event than Demetrius Andrade versus Luke Keeler. Nothing against Demetrius Andrade or Luke Keeler, but that matchup doesn't have all the intrigue, all the sizzle that the Diaz versus Farmer fight has. You know, it's kind of strange that they set it up this way, but you know, one way or another, regardless of the order, we're going to get to see it, so it's really not that big a deal. I just happen to think that, you know, the more intriguing matchup should always be the one that caps the night off.
Now, on that same card, the unified super bantamweight champion, the only unified super bantamweight champion, Daniel Roman, is going to be back in action, and I have similar sentiments when it comes to Daniel. That, you know, he's holding two world titles, but for what it's worth, he's flying relatively low on the radar. And it's because there are two other world champions in that same weight class, and he needs to be fighting those guys, because unless it's one of those guys, the matchups they're making for him, they're just not going to get much attention. In his division, you have Emmanuel Navarrete, the WBO champion. You have Ray Vargas, the WBC champion. And at least one of those fights should be made. You know, Ray Vargas is on the DAZN side of the street right there with Daniel. I mean, Daniel's with Matchroom and Ray is with Golden Boy, but all things considered, it should be a doable fight because they're fighting on the same platform. And I think no other fight other than that fight makes sense for either of those two guys.
We all know historically that the lower weights don't always get the same attention as the glamour divisions, the glamour weights like welterweight, a middleweight, a heavyweight. So the only real way you can get attention for the guys down there at super bantamweight is to match the very best against the very best in unification fights where the most is at stake, where the most is on the line. That will get people to pay attention. They're both on the same platform, more or less, they are, so I don't see why we shouldn't get that fight at minimum sometime next year. Let's just hope that Daniel Roman can hang on to those two world titles, the WBA and the IBF, long enough that we can see him unify them with someone else.